Turn to Deuteronomy 28. Deuteronomy 28. I want to show you that God... Thanks, Brother Carlos. I want to show you that God wants us involved in our success. It's real important for you to realize the difference between God making decisions and you making a decision. The quality of my life is determined by my decisions, not God's. I have a persuasion that the Bible is about knowledge. Hosea 4:6, my people are destroyed for lack of knowledge. Now there's a difference between ignorance and stupid. Now many people don't like the word stupid, and I just hadn't found a better word to describe what I feel. I could say unwise. I could say mentally challenged. That's a nice political word, huh? My people are destroyed for lack of knowledge. Knowledge, ignorance is when I don't know something. Stupid is when I make no effort to learn. Somebody comes up to me and say, here's a wonderful teacher. Say, I love the presence of God in Spanish. I love the presence of God.
Amo la presencia de Dios en español. In Spanish, I'm saying it in Spanish.
Oh, I thought it was Polish. Okay, say it again, one more time.
Amo la presencia de Dios.
I don't know what she said. Why? Because I'm ignorant in Spanish. Stupid is when I say, oh, well, that's stupid. Intelligence is when I say, what did you say and what language was that?
I was saying it in Spanish, sir.
What was you saying in Spanish?
Amo la presencia.
No, what was you saying in Spanish? Say it in English. I'm sorry. Say in English what you were saying in Spanish.
I was saying, I love the presence of God.
Okay. Ignorance is when I don't know something. Stupid is when I make no effort to know. So look at somebody and say, I'm not stupid, just a little ignorant. Deuteronomy 28 is, we call it the blessing chapter, though some of it's a curse, but we only deal with the first 14. I don't preach to rebels, I only preach to the obedient. And other people have a message for the rebels, I don't. But Deuteronomy 28 says, it shall come to pass. That means there's a process. I call it the law of eventuality. I was in New Orleans. I was 21, 22 years old. The pastor weighed about 400 pounds. I looked across the table after church Sunday night and I said, how on earth did you become so huge? I had not studied the law of protocol. I had not studied how to be gracious. But I was real direct. How did you get so huge? And he looked at me rather coldly. And he said, eating every night after church, just like you're doing right now. The law of eventuality. Whatever you're doing has a future. Every day is a seed, and you're walking toward a harvest every day of your life. Lung cancer, the law of eventuality. He says, it shall come to pass if thou, God does not take responsibility for my prosperity. I emphasize prosperity in our ministry because it's the missing part of our life. We've got almost everything but money. We fell in love with God. We found something solid we can trust. We've got passion for our assignment. We've got a family we adore. But we don't have money. So we live in houses that are unsafe. We live in neighborhoods that you can't walk at night. Our car breaks down. We can't get it fixed, except by the neighbor who hadn't been able to fix his car for 2 years. I've always wondered about these men that work on their cars for 3 and 4 years. You drive by the house, and they've got the hood of the car up, and they're all working. The whole neighborhood's working on it. And next month, it's still there. 2 years later, it's still there. It's a full-time job to them to make that car run. We need money. We want to prosper. How do I produce? What inside of me is stopping the flow of prosperity? It's big to me, very important to me. I'm not the kind of preacher that's going to try to get you to forget about it. Just stay in the secret place, fast for 3 or 4 days, and an angel will show up with an apple. No, God wants us to prosper. Watch how he says, if thou, that's me and you, shalt hearken diligently unto the voice of the Lord thy God, to observe and to do all his commandments, which I command thee this day, that you'll make God happy. No, that the Lord thy God will set thee on high, above all nations of the earth. And all these blessings, and he's going to give us a list of what happens when I obey the law of God. The law of focus. I don't have to be a Christian for the law of focus to work for me. There are laws on the earth. The law of focus, this one thing I do, my heart is set, forgetting those things behind me. Joshua 1:7-8, don't look to the right or to the left. Focus, 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 focus. He says, remember Lot's wife, because her focus was broken. She looked back at Sodom and Gomorrah and became a pillar of salt. Interesting, isn't it? All these blessings shall come. Now, God's very reward conscious. Now, there's two kinds of ministries, responsibility conscious and reward conscious. Responsibility conscious ministry says you need to do this, you need to remember to do this, remember to do that. Reward conscious, a responsibility conscious is like a James Robinson. A reward conscious is like a Kenneth Copeland, where he shows you the rewards of following the Bible. Two kinds. One ministry teaches you got to do this, you need to do this, you need to do that, and they're not wrong, they're right. The other ministry says this is what will happen when you obey. One ministry teaches you what's going to happen if you don't obey. The other ministry teaches you what's going to happen when you do obey. Both are correct. It's like doctors. Somebody said, well, I want you to preach the whole gospel. Oh, I won't have enough years to preach the whole gospel. I can believe the whole gospel, but I don't have enough years. I'm not Methuselah. All these blessings shall come on thee and overtake thee if God loves you. No, not if God loves you. If thou hearken unto the voice of the Lord thy God. Then he says, blessed shalt thou be in the city. Blessed shalt thou be in the field. Blessed shall be the fruit of thy body and the fruit of thy ground, the fruit of thy cattle, the increase of thy kind, the flocks of thy sheep. What's he doing? He's telling us what's the reward. Now you tell your son, if you'll mow the yard, daddy will give you $20. Daddy, I don't want to mow. Okay, son, you got it. It's, you know, it's not all about $20. I have a belt here. Come over here to the room, and we're going to have another little system that works for you. Oh, Daddy, I really do want to mow the yard. I've made a decision. So the purpose of the pain zone of the gospel is to help motivate you to do the gospel. Would you live in a city without stop signs? I wouldn't. Would you want to live in a city without traffic lights? Stop here, we'll let you know when to go. No, I wouldn't want to live in a city without a policeman. It's called law and order. The purpose of a law is to keep order. You're driving down the road and it suddenly says, stay to the right. Why do you do that? Because you love being commanded things? Yes, sir, I'll stay. No, you're trying to keep order so there's safety. So you can live another day, and people that break the law are placed in a place we call prison. The reward of following the law is I get to be free. I like being free. I don't like an 8x6 cell. I don't care how good looking the guards are, I don't want to be in the prison. I know the food is free, but I don't want to be in prison. I know I get a free place to sleep in that cell, but I don't want to be there. Dr. Smalley, it is great to see one of our board members here today, a fabulous man of God we adore, and he will be preaching this weekend with us here at the conference. We love his ministry and love what he is doing for God. Amen. No, I don't. I like freedom. And God's telling you, here's what's in it for you. I hear people, don't always be asking what's in it for you. Why not? Why wouldn't I? Why wouldn't I? I taught them in this morning the necessity of their joy. An unhappy man creates an unhappy home. No, your wife comes second. You come first. A man's got to take care of his mind. He's got to take care of his life. He's got to take care, because if a man is happy in his government of his territory, he'll create joy in that environment. He'll produce. Why shouldn't I? That's what it's about. I love that song, It's All About Him, but it really isn't. You think he died for himself? You think the cross is so Jesus would feel good? You think God felt great satisfaction watching eight inches of thorns crushed into his brow, a spear in his side, spikes in his hands, 39 stripes across his back? You think God did that for himself? You think Jesus said, I just want to see how it feels to hurt? I've been in heaven all these years. I need to feel. Are you kidding? It's not all about him. It's about us. We are the offspring of the Most High God. The blood was shed for us. The cross was for us. The resurrection was for us. The healing stripes of Jesus were for us. No, it's not all about him. It's about us, his offspring. Oh, hallelujah. Hallelujah. And he is stating here, this is what's in it. Blessed shall be thy basket. And look at this. And thy store. So he expected you to be in business. Actually, this means like a storage warehouse. Blessed shalt thou be when thou comest in. Blessed shalt thou be when thou goest out. God expected you to travel, Amy. I bought you something for your Paris trip yesterday. We got all excited here one day and found out that was one of Laura's dreams, is to go to Paris. And the church here bought her, 20 people bought her ticket to Paris. And then I looked over here and saw my sister Flo as she shook a fist at me. I always wanted to go to Paris too. I said, okay, sis, I'll pay your way too. Then I realized I needed somebody to take care of him. So Denise, would you stand? So Denise is on that trip because she's going to be taking care of them. And her mother's on the trip. Where's Miguel? And is Miguel working today? And Mrs. Stella. But I bought that. Now, God said, I'm going to bless you going in. I'm going to bless you going out. Wow. Wow. Now, Mike, how can I get into that blessed life? I want to talk to you about some ways, and we've been covering this for a couple of weeks, but I want to talk to you about some things that you can do, things that you can do to accelerate. See, I don't wait. I don't believe in waiting. Waiting's when you don't know something. You wait when you don't know something. I was in the doctor's office the other day at teeth. Dental. And I said, why am I waiting? Because I don't believe in waiting. Brother Mike, I do. I bet you have to wait too, don't you? Yep. Whatever you believe, that's going. See, I believe in movement. I believe in reaching. I'm not like the woman in the back of the crowd that says, well, Jesus knows where I am. If he wants to heal me, he knows where I'm at. No, I'm like the woman says, if I can touch the hem of his garment, I know I'll be made whole. I'm the kind of guy that breaks through the roof to get Jesus touch my friend. Oh, hallelujah. You wait when you don't have information. You wait when you don't have something. You wait when you don't know something. But God did not make us to walk through life and just sit and walk through the garden. What do I want to experience? Here's some of the things that's going to help accelerate. Number one, set clear goals. Set clear goals. Your home should be a dream world where pictures of your future are on the walls. Pictures of the future. Why do you have pictures of other people's houses? You should only have a picture of somebody's house if that's the house you want to live in. You should put pictures of your future on at least one wall in your house. There should be a dream wall. Your house should talk to me. It should talk to me about your future. It should tell me about your desires. This is what I want. This is what I like. Put in front of you what makes you excited. It's your responsibility to keep yourself excited. Amy won't mind me mentioning this, I don't think. But I was trying to lose weight, always trying to lose weight, always trying to lose weight. And I can say no to a lot of things. I can say no to a casino. I can say no to liquor. I cannot say no to a donut. And she meets me at the airport. I don't think it was 12. I think it was 18 donuts. Was it 12 or 18? 12? When I see a donut, I lose sight of everything. Everything. I can't think straight. My heart pounds. Why? I link it, Keith, to every other donut I ever ate in my life. I remember how it tastes. I remember how it tastes. I remember, and I like chocolate covered donuts. The other night I was watching a little movie about a lady who opened a chocolate shop. I actually went through about a half hour of wondering where I could put a chocolate shop at the Wisdom Center. I actually did. It's not over. I'm still battling that thought because, boy, if God doesn't show up, at least you've got chocolate to eat on. I love donuts. And I was upset. I said, Miss Amy, you know I'm trying to lose weight. I know, Dr. Murdock, but I know how much you love donuts. So I got real upset. because she wasn't helping me lose weight. So I went to God about her life. And I asked the Holy Spirit, what devil jumped into her? Where did it happen in her life? But I was upset because she didn't help me lose weight. Help me lose weight. And the Lord began to actually spoke for hours on keeping myself inspired. You must keep yourself inspired. It's nobody else's responsibility. It's not even Sister Jackie's responsibility to keep Brother Holton happy. It's not even Yolanda's responsibility to keep Brother Mauricio happy. That's not her responsibility. You got to keep yourself. Yuri, you got to keep yourself. What makes you smile? What makes you happy? God spoke to my heart. Remove off the walls anything that's not making you happy. I had a family pictures on the wall. I've told about this several times. And there's a niece I don't like. She has a brother who's lazy. So I took both of their pictures off the wall. Had a lady say, Brother Mike, Jesus loves everybody. I said, I ain't Jesus. Whoever told you I was Jesus? That's why he gets to be Jesus. He can love everybody. And I just take off the walls what does not excite me. I put in front of me something that makes me smile. Something that makes me happy. Find three inspirations every day. When I get in a bad mood, which can happen as quickly as I get happy. I have no idea why that is. I can be happy and somebody do something and suddenly I'm another man. That I'm another man. How many go through a metamorphosis? How many become several people? How many have wondered about that? How many have thought you might be sick in some way? Me too. But when I saw how fast I could get happy again, you know who I think of? I think of Angelica and Lala. Lala is as bold as a lion, but she's gracious about it. She smiles at you, and there's a mischievous smile. Isn't it? And Angelica, her sister, just watches. I've spent hours and hours with them. I've watched Lala as she sneaks over to do something. She sends a smile your way. And when I feel a little rough, I start thinking of Lala's mischievous look, and I just start smiling. I start thinking of Angelica. Angelica, stand. I want them to see how you smile. Smile big. Smile big, baby. Those teeth are straight from heaven. Yeah. And I start thinking. It's your reason. Thank you, baby. It's good for you to keep things that inspire you. You have to look for them. I went to Pier, I think it's called Pier 1 the other night. And I was... If you ever go to Pier 1, there's so many different kind of things. And they have some balls there that are just beautiful color, just $4 a piece, $4 a piece. So I took everything they had in the store there. They had a big thing there. And I just, because it's only $4 a piece. Oh, to be able to excite yourself for $4, do you realize what a deal that is? She has to go to Paris to smile. I smile by seeing just a ball. Do you know how to keep yourself inspired? That's why you put goals around and you excite yourself about the future. God gives you pictures of the future you can have. And you put those, I love magazines. For $6, I can buy the thoughts of a billion-dollar corporation. For $6, I can go through just the joy of looking. Wow, I want that waterfall. Wow, oh, I'd like to have that. Look at that. And I'll tear out those pages and I take pictures with my phone. Why? I want to feel good. Is there anything wrong with feeling good? No. Revelation 4:11 says, everything God made, he made for his pleasure. God is into fun. You're kidding. Some of you think that heaven's going to be like an indoor cemetery, where we all sit there. Thou art the God of the universe. And all the angels say, yes, he is. Yes, he is. Heaven's not going to be like that. Are you kidding? Heaven is the best ideas God ever had without the presence of any rebels. Oh, hallelujah. Master, keeping yourself inspired. Then you've got to master the art of receiving. Life is all about receiving. Now, you don't read that in Twitter. Life is about giving. Don't you give with expecting. Have you ever heard that? Don't give expecting something back. Ignoramus, who would do that? Who would do that? When's the last time you walked in Walmart and said, I was just driving by, here's $200. No, I'm not going to buy anything. Just going to be, I'm a giver. Here's $200. You go to the cleaners and you drop off $100 to the cleaners. You're just a giver. If you can survive the ignorance around you, you'll have heaven on earth in your life. Never tire of the wisdom of God. Wisdom is the ability to recognize difference, right and wrong, evil and righteousness, difference in people, difference in a countenance, difference in a moment, like the blind man crying out to Jesus. The dominant purpose for wisdom, and don't you love the wisdom of God? So thankful you're listening today and watching and being a part of the internet, telling others about it. And I hope you're getting, by the way, I hope you're getting my daily podcast every single day on your iPod or your MP3. Every single day, 2 minutes of wisdom. Be a blessing. Sometimes I go a little over because I get excited. I want you to be a part of this ministry. I believe that when you get involved with God, he gets involved with you. I am one of the ministers of the gospel who believe the words of Jesus. I believe every word he said. When he told Peter that there would be a 100-fold return on any investment in the gospel, in Mark 10, 28 through 30, I believed him. When the word of God says in Malachi 3, that if I bring the tithe, which is 10% of my income, and the offering back to him, that he would open the windows of heaven and pour me out a blessing I don't have room enough to receive, I believe him. Why would I believe God about heaven and hell and not believe him about the blessing of the Lord? I want to pray over the seeds that you have been planting in this ministry. And by the way, I have an incredible gift you're going to love. In fact, it's probably one of the greatest gifts I've ever offered. We're asking the Holy Spirit for 300 partners this week who will set aside a seed of $300 for our outreaches. I need your help. I want you to help me. Not just to feed 1,000 children a day, which we do, or 1,000 families, or underwrite the Wisdom of Asia Bible College, but that we can go into 100 countries with the gospel. I'm holding in my hand the Wisdom Quick Scan Bible. The Wisdom Quick Scan Bible. I have never in my life found a Bible easier to read. As you know, for many years, I've read the Bible through 40 chapters a day every single month of my life. There is no easier book to read than this quick scan Bible. When I found out that I could offer it to you inside of some of the teaching that I've been doing and I'll do today, I want you to have it. Call me right now, plant your seed of 300 and watch God move. The whole Bible is a book about receiving. Adam, oh, I love this picture. I could teach it every day of my life. Adam, I want you to receive a garden. God's first gift to a human was land. This is the year for territory. If you've ever wanted a house, this is the year for your house. If you've ever wanted property, this is the year for property. If you've ever wanted God to bless you with territory, say, I have territory that belongs to me. Say it again, I have territory that belongs to me. The first first gift God ever gave to a human was land. I want you to have a garden. Whew. Trees, flowers. And then one day, Adam was talking to God and said, I'm so lonely. The trees won't talk to me. There's no sound here. It's too quiet. I need some fellowship. When I walk by the trees, they stay there. They won't move with me. When I walk, I'm the only one. And so God said, let's try. Let's try Lassie. Let's try a dog. So God made some animals. And Adam awakened, and Lassie was licking his face. A giraffe was over him, looking at him. A lion was about 20 feet away. Several horses were grazing. And Adam says, thank you, Father. Thank you. I receive these animals. I become the zookeeper. And suddenly looks in the trees and there's a monkey going through his little... Animals were made for our enjoyment. Inside your tummy or watching them. Now this was incredible. There's something that God wanted us to understand. He was trying to think of things for Adam to receive. And Adam said, it's true. They're making a lot of noise, but they don't really understand me. They don't really, and God says, okay. And God was walking with Adam. Every day, they were walking together in the garden, talking. And can you hear Adam saying, I don't have anything against you, God, but you're not as fun as I thought you'd be. And God said, I've got to give Adam something I'm not. And Adam woke up, whoo! He said to God, what is this? I've seen giraffes. I've seen lions. I've seen monkeys. And God looks at him and said, I let you name everything in the zoo. So now you can name her. And he said, whoa, man. He got to name woman. John 1:11 says he came into his own received him not. You were made to receive. We receive the love of Christ. Baby, we receive love from those around us. We receive mercy when we've done wrong. We receive information from God. We receive gifts from people. We receive. I walked by Dr. Kimball. Where are you, Dr. Kimball? I walked by her a few days ago. 80 years old. I don't think she lies. I don't think she lies. But when she says I'm 80, it's just hard to believe her. Would you stand? I want the people to see how good looking you are. 80 years old. And when I walked by the other day, and the Holy Spirit spoke to me and says, treat her like a mother. Treat her like you would treat your own mother. And I stopped and says, is there anything at your house you need? Is there a washing machine? Is there something you need? And she said, well, I've got some plumbing situations. I said, tomorrow morning at 10 o'clock, my plumber will be at your house. And he came and he started the work. And then I said, is there anything else? And she said, well, yes, there's several things that I'd like at my house. I said, we're going to make, and so you may be seated. So my little sister called me. She says, there's something else that Dr. Kimball needs. Do I have approval? I said, anything she wants, she gets. Take care of her as long as she's got a need. Just say, I am a master receiver. Say it again. So ladies, when a man comes up and says, oh, I love your dress today. Don't say, this old thing. I got it in the flea market for $4. That's what I learn to say, thank you for that. And say thank you as if it was unexpected. You can always tell a woman who's been beautiful from her childhood. She don't know how to receive compliments. Watch the woman who's been a pretty child. Now she says it like this. You tell me if I'm not correct. Oh, that's kind of you. Is that not the? That's kind of you. Like, this is the 4,000th time somebody's told me how cute I was. Learn to say, why? Why? Thank you. Or like one little girl told me the other day, I said, you're so pretty. She said, I know, everybody tells me. She got ugly just like that, just like that, just like that. So when it comes out, you got a fabulous smile, honey. You're going to be a millionaire. There's not a doubt in my mind. You're going to be a millionaire because people can trust you. She's got a savings account. Honey, a woman was made for man to be a wealth manager. That's the purpose of a woman. The purpose of a man is to bring in the money. The purpose of the woman is to spend it. Mm-hmm. And if you spend it right, there's more that comes back. Say, I will master the art of receiving. Say it again, I will master the art of receiving. Say it again, I will master the art of receiving. Now you've heard this. This has been taught. You gotta give before you get anything back. How many's ever heard that? You gotta give first. How, Dana, how can you give until you've received? Say that out loud.
You have to receive something so you have something to give back.
Thank you. You have to receive before you can give. A lady told me, she said, I've given and given and given. And she said, I've just given for years and God's never blessed me. I said, you write a book. You tell us where that money you gave away so much came from. Did you steal it? Rob it, break into your mother's drawers. What you do? How can you give and give and give? How many's ever heard somebody say, I've given and given and never got back? Where did you get all that from? That you've been given. Tell someone next to you, said, are you ignorant or stupid? Just look at them, say, are you ignorant or are you stupid? Would you come help me, Marianne? Look at someone next to you and say, master the art of receiving. Oh, say it again, master the art of receiving. So this week, we're going to go to our house. We're going to put pictures on the wall. This is my future. This, whatever inspires you. I saw a picture of myself the other day. And in that particular picture, I was kind of cute. My sisters told me we liked that picture. I looked like a boxer coming out of a shower. And I was like 180 pounds. Whew. I used to put my picture of my head on top of Arnold Schwarzenegger's body. And I'd put it in my gym and when I worked out. I received joy this week. I received laughter. I received the mercies of God. I received the goodness of God. I received divine health, divine healing. I receive opportunity. Oh, hallelujah. I receive opportunity. I receive Jehovah Jireh's covenant with me. Just say it out loud. I'm a master receiver. I got through teaching. A man asked one day to speak for his organization. If you learn how to receive, see, the way you receive is your gift back to a giver. Pastor Ron Bowman has traveled all over the world with me. And one day he told me, we was coming back from Nigeria, and said, I want you to watch Lisa. So his wife met him at the airport and he pulls out a bag of perfumes for her. She didn't take the bag and say, how much this cost? You know this isn't my favorite. I told you red was my favorite. No, she squealed. She screamed. She twirled. I almost wanted to be married just watching her react. She grabbed him, kissed him, and he was sitting there. He went. How are you at receiving? Hallelujah. Baby. Get good at receiving. The other day, the Lord led us to bless her. And she began to cry, and she was so thankful. And her face stayed in my mind for hours because her receiving. That's why Mary Magdalene was crying at the feet of Jesus, washing his feet with perfume and drying his feet with her long hair. Why was she crying? Because he caught her? Was she crying because he discerned her sins? Was she crying because he says, I know what you really are? She was crying because she had just received mercy. I receive mercy today. I receive divine presence today. Oh, hallelujah. Hallelujah. Say, I'm a master receiver. Say it again. I'm a master receiver. Hallelujah. I want every man in this room to stand. Every man in this house to stand. I want every man to come and stand here in front of this platform for a few moments with me. Men, you are the kings of your territory. You're the kings of your domain. Your presence creates an aura of protection in your house. Your kids sleep at night because daddy's here. Your wife is joyful because her king is in the house. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I want you to master the art of receiving. Men, I want you to journal. Because today, February the 15th, 16th, February the 16th, today is the poorest you will ever be the rest of your life. I said, today is the poorest you will ever be the rest of your life. I want to tell you five things that's going to be happening. They will happen within 7 weeks from today. Number one. Somebody owes you something. It may be something you don't even know about, but they owe you. There's someone right now that feels like they owe a debt to you. You've done something for them. You've helped them. You've been a blessing to them, and they haven't forgotten it. They're going to have a Mordecai moment. 7 times 7 is 49 days. Who will look up that? Miss Sonia, look up on a calendar 49 days from now. I need to know the date. Because the word from the Lord for you today is within 49 days from today, somebody's going to have a Mordecai moment. Somebody's late at night, they're going to suddenly be brought to a remembrance. Joseph, get this, son. Get this. Get this. This is important. Someone's going to be reminded that they should bless you. It may be $100 bill. It may be a promotion. It may be a raise. There is no limit to what God's about to do. No limit to what God is about to do. 49 days, there's going to be a Mordecai moment. A partner is going to write you, call you, and say, Dr. Mike, I forgot my faith promise, and I'm sending you a check for an entire year of my giving. 49 days. Hallelujah. 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 Say, I receive. Say it again, I receive. Say it again, I'm a receiver. Second thing that's going to happen is somebody is going to commend you. Your name is going to be brought up, and you're going to have a new relationship with somebody who's capable of blessing you. It may be with a job, but your name is going to come up, and somebody's going to speak in your favor. Now, you don't need 100 people to make your life happy. You just need one person at a time to be good to you. You don't need to own a restaurant to get full, do you? You don't have to go to China to get Chinese food. Moments from now, it's going to start. Within 49 days, there's going to be a collection of blessings upon your life. In 49 days, you're going to feel a new level of confidence as a man. You're going to actually get a little cocky, and it's scripturally correct. Your shoulders are going to come back, and you're going to change. Your wife's going to notice the difference, Yuri. Your wife's going to notice the difference. She's going to notice there's going to be a volcano in you. A volcano in you. And you're going to say, God's given me the greatest thoughts I've ever had. This is the year of the spectacular. The spectacular. The spectacular. Your life is going to change. In 49 days, you won't even believe you're the same man. In 49 days, you'll be back up here. And you're going to, every time I give you a little testimony, you'll say, that's happening to me. Every time I give you a testimony, like I'll give you a testimony next Sunday about the man last week who called my office and said, how much money does Mike need for the Timothy house? They said, we need another $100,000. He said, I'll pay it all, whatever it is. Oh, the next 49 days are going to blow you away. I said the next 49 days are going to blow you away. Remember I told you. Remember I told you. Remember I told you. Get ready, preacher son. Get ready to open the envelope like I did this week and pulled out a check of a man who became a multimillionaire through sowing $1,000 seed. Listening to me on television. A Brazilian man. Come up here, brother Brazilian man. I want you to get ready in 49 days to open your mail. And you're going to pull out a check. And your heart's going to stop. Your hands are going to go up. And say, Brother Mike said this would happen to me. Are you ready for some surprise money? Are you comfortable with money? You are. Prosperity won't make you backslide. When God blesses you, you won't quit playing the piano. A Brazilian man who became a millionaire through my teaching this week wrote me a note thanking me for unlocking his faith. And he sent me his tithe for that week, because he's been telling me he's sending tithe and he's been sending checks. But his tithe last week was $350,000. And so that was his tithe. Say it out loud, I'm getting good at receiving. Oh, say it again, I'm getting good at receiving. When I tell you that today is the poorest you will ever be, get excited. Son, I had a man to ask me if I would teach his leaders. And I said, I'd be happy to. He said, what does it cost? I said, oh, I'm free. And when I got through teaching that morning, he was crying. And he said, I've never done this before. Would you receive a gift from me? I said, oh, I'm a world-class receiver. I'm a world-class. And son, he took off his $28,000 Rolex and put it on my wrist. And 2 weeks later, he wrote me a note. You've changed my business. You've changed my life. Here's a thank you seed. You know what the seed was? Not $20, not $100. His gift to me was $100,000. Oh, come on, clap with joy. Wipe the jealousy off your face. Wipe the jealousy off your face. Say, I'm a world-class receiver. Say it again, I'm a world-class receiver. I'm a world-class receiver. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. April 6th is 49 days from now. Strut. Hold your head up. Hallelujah. Walk like a receiver. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. All across this room, stand. Stretch forth your hand toward the men of this house. They're going to be the most successful men that's ever lived in their genealogy. They're going to succeed beyond every member of their family. Every one of you are going to become trophies on display. God's going to bless you like you've never been blessed before. Every word that comes out of your mouth will be integrous. People will know when your name is called, he's a man of credibility. He's a man that can be trusted. Hallelujah. When somebody calls your name, there'll be three or four people around them and say, he's a good man. He will always do what he said he will do. Everybody lift both hands high. Father, I decree every man in this house to be blessed. I decree that every surprise gift you have for them will come out from the north, the south, the east, and the west. There will be surprise conversations. There will be electrifying relationships. There will be open doors that's never happened in the history of their life. Open doors that's never happened in the history of their life. Father, I decree that everything you do for me, you do for them. Because the same anointing I love is the anointing they love. We love the anointing of wisdom. And like Elisha looked at Elijah and said, I want twice everything God has done for you. We say here today, double your anointing upon our life. We are receivers of the anointing. Oh, men, say that aloud. Lord, I receive double anointing. My decisions will be financially successful. Everything that I do will bring honor to you. I walk in obedience. I walk in obedience. And beginning today, 49 days of supernatural blessing, supernatural open doors. I will open the mail knowing a blessing is there for me. Father, I carry the anointing of divine favor upon me. And every environment I enter, every environment I enter will change because of my presence. Oh, hallelujah. Hallelujah. Say it aloud. Every environment I enter, every environment I enter, every environment I enter shall be changed. In Jesus' name, it is done. Give God a hand clap of praise. It is done. It is done. Oh, hallelujah. Hallelujah. The harvest is about to catch up with you. I said the harvest is about to catch up with you. Are you ready? The harvest is about to catch up with you. Just to do this. Say, I'm a receiver. Say, I'm a receiver. Somebody is going to hear from God. And you're going to have a testimony. The testimonies will start next Sunday. In every service, we'll have a testimony of what God did in the first 7 days. 49 days of the supernatural. 49 days of the supernatural. Hallelujah. Oh, hallelujah. 49 days of the supernatural. I never tire of the wisdom of God. Wisdom is the ability to recognize difference, right and wrong, evil and righteousness, difference in people, difference in a countenance, difference in a moment, like the blind man crying out to Jesus. The dominant purpose for wisdom, and don't you love the wisdom of God? So thankful you're listening today and watching and being a part of the internet, telling others about it. And I hope you're getting, by the way, I hope you're getting my daily podcast every single day on your iPod or your MP3. Every single day, 2 minutes of wisdom. Be a blessing. Sometimes I go a little over because I get excited. I want you to be a part of this ministry. I believe that when you get involved with God, He gets involved with you. I am one of the ministers of the gospel who believe the words of Jesus. I believe every word He said. When He told Peter that there would be a 100-fold return on any investment in the gospel, in Mark 10, 28 through 30, I believed Him. When the word of God says in Malachi 3, that if I bring the tithe, which is 10% of my income, and the offering back to Him, that He would open the windows of heaven and pour me out a blessing I don't have room enough to receive, I believe Him. Why would I believe God about heaven and hell and not believe Him about the blessing of the Lord? I want to pray over the seeds that you have been planting in this ministry. And by the way, I have an incredible gift you're going to love. In fact, it's probably one of the greatest gifts I've ever offered. We're asking the Holy Spirit for 300 partners this week who will set aside a seed of $300 for our outreaches. I need your help. I want you to help me. Not just to feed 1,000 children a day, which we do, or 1,000 families, or underwrite the Wisdom of Asia Bible College, but that we can go into 100 countries with the gospel. I'm holding in my hand the Wisdom Quick Scan Bible. The Wisdom Quick Scan Bible. I have never in my life found a Bible easier to read. As you know, for many years, I've read the Bible through 40 chapters a day every single month of my life. There is no easier book to read than this quick scan Bible. When I found out that I could offer it to you inside of some of the teaching that I've been doing and I'll do today, I want you to have it. Call me right now, plant your seed of 300, and watch God move.